Hello. My name is Doug Coker. I'm a software engineer working on the Google Gadgets API, and I'm going to talk to you about two big issues about gadget development today. One is distribution, and the other is some tech tricks that, if you're familiar with gadgets, you might not have seen before. I'm just curious, how many of you have actually built a gadget already? Okay. How many of you use the iGoogle product? Okay, cool. So you guys are already kind of familiar with gadgets in general. So there's my agenda. So what are Google Gadgets? Google Gadgets are HTML content inside an XML wrapper. Any content you can put in an XML page, HTML page, you can throw in this XML wrapper, and you can then distribute it through any mechanism that Google Gadgets are supported on. And there's a bunch of those, and I'll go into those in a second. And when I say you can put anything in a Google Gadget, you can. HTML, JavaScript, CSS, Flash. You can make AJAX-y, XML, HTTP requests, and all that stuff. And one of the nice parts about working with gadgets is that Google will host all the content for you. Open source projects can use the Google Code Hosting Subversion Repository, which provides a really nice versioned content store for images and data. And Google Pages provides another alternative. So here are some examples of Google gadgets that are popular on the iGoogle product. You can see that we can display feeds quite easily. There's a Calvin and Hobbes feed. We can display Flash apps very easily also. There's personalized data in the interesting items gadget and the daylight map, which is written by someone who's in attendance today. It actually uses the Google Maps API to display data. There's actually a lot of other interesting gadgets in here also. This is the gadgets directory on the iGoogle product, and you can see that there's a wide variety of content here. Some of it is pretty strongly branded content, and some of it is just hobby fun content, like an animated spider. So, who writes gadgets? There's all kinds of people who write gadgets. They are motivated by all kinds of different reasons. Some are just hobbyists, and some are doing it to extend the reach of their brand. An example of someone who does gadgets as a hobby is this guy, who's one of our top developers. He's built this kind of community around his gadgets. He has these pages dedicated to them, and you can drill through these details if the net works, which it is kind of working. So you can learn more about his gadgets, and then you can click this Add to Google button, add those gadgets to the user's personalized homepage. Businesses also build gadgets because it's a really useful mechanism to distribute their content. It extends brand reach. So if you're a content producer and you want your brand to reach into the user's iGoogle experience, then you can use gadgets to do so. There's some really good examples of that here. Everyone from small businesses to large businesses are making these gadgets. Sonic Living is a small company in California that distributes concert event information, and they're using gadgets to increase their user base. Travelocity and American Airlines have these very strongly useful but also strongly branded content. So if you're an American Airlines flyer, you might prefer to have this gadget on your page so you can make searches and use your frequent flyer miles. There's also some, it also applies to media. These two gadgets are basically authored by Entertainment Weekly, and the one on the left displays TV listings, and it fetches these TV listings with some API methods that we provide so that you can interact with remote content. And then there's very topic-specific long-tail stuff like lost dedicated gadgets. Another reason people build gadgets is because the growth is phenomenal. It's an amazing distribution channel. We have over 800 million page views per week for the gadgets right now. And what's not on this graph that I'd like to have there is the number of developers and the growth curve for the developers. Right now we're at tens of thousands of developers, and these are developers outside of Google who are using our API to build these gadgets. So, I've shown you some introduction to what gadgets are. Where can you use them? You've probably seen them here already. These are gadgets on the iGoogle page. These are gadgets people have added to their homepage and interact with every day. A lot of these gadgets store information about the user's entered in. One of my personal favorites is the water tracker gadget, which I think is a really cute example of someone writing a gadget for something, for a topic that's interesting to them. This helps you track how much water you've drinking every day. And it fills up the glasses as you're drinking more water. And the upper left-hand corner uses some of our other APIs to fetch video content. You can also use gadgets in Blogger and Google Pages. It's pretty easy to do. On Blogger, you just go embed content, and you can paste in this script tag that we provide you, and it will render the content on your blog. This is really neat if you have like a very targeted blog, such as a blog about London. You could have a gadget that displays a map of London on your blog, and it's basically a code-free solution. You just have to copy and paste this thing in, and you're all set. The gadgets also render on Google Desktop. They look pretty much just like any native Google Desktop gadget, which is pretty nice. And there are third-party products that will actually let gadgets render on Vista and OS X Dashboard. Gadgets can also be used in the enterprise and portal software. IBM recently released this portlet for Google Gadgets, which lets you render pretty much any Google gadget in your enterprise portal. So, one of the most interesting applications of gadgets is using them to render on third-party websites. So, you can create a gadget, and then you can have, or anyone who has a page on the web can take that gadget and stick it on their page. And so, this is an example of a travel site in Mexico that uses a gadget that someone wrote to display a webcam as part of their promotional material on their webpage. As I said, you can put this content on any website, and you get the snippet of code that you need to use through this page. That I'll show you in a second, if the internet works. We'll see. So this is one of my favorite gadgets also. This is a pony, and you can customize the pony to your personal color preferences, if the internet works. You can make it as ugly as you want. So once you've personalized your pony to your preferences, you can go down here and click Get the Code. You can copy and paste this into any web application that accepts script tags or into Blogger or wherever else, and then you have a pony on your web page. Users find these gadgets through the gadgets directory. So when you write a gadget, your gadget will appear in this directory. As you can see, this is internationalized, so the gadgets directory is internationalized to, I believe, over 26 countries. And when the user adds these gadgets to their page, they're also localized through an API that I'll describe later. You get your gadget into this directory by submitting it through this process. So once you build your gadget, you've hosted it somewhere, you can just paste the URL into the gadget URL section, and we will run your gadget through a series of tests. These tests make sure that you have the right metadata information to make sure your gadget succeeds in the directory. And this is what your gadget will look like in the directory. The description, which is part of the gadget metadata that you provide, is displayed here along with the title and authorship information. Another way you can get distribution for your gadget is to use these add to Google buttons. So we saw them earlier on the like Puerto Vallarta page and the Blogger page, these little buttons say add to Google, you click the button and that gadget gets added to your iGoogle. You can also customize those gadgets. So let's say your gadget can be colored like a different background color. These are configured via user preferences, which I'll talk about in a few minutes, but you can pre-configure the gadgets by modifying the URL parameters. You can also distribute your gadget with a send to a friend method. This introduces a viral sharing feature, which is pretty powerful and has been very, very popular with users. So you can send a friend, enter their email, and they'll get an email with a link that they can click to add the content to their page. All right, I think I'm done talking about distribution. So I'm gonna talk about what's in a Google gadget and then maybe do a demo if the internet is willing. There are basically three chunks to a gadget specification file. They're just standard XML files. The first section, which says module prefs, has metadata about your gadget. The title and height and some other fields control what the gadget looks like on the personalized homepage. The title will show up as a title. Height controls the initial height of the gadget on the container. That information is also used in the directory. So the title goes into the directory as the description and authorship information. Another set of fields in the gadget spec are user preferences. There are some others, and we'll talk about them in a bit. User preferences are really interesting because this is how you allow your users to personalize your gadget. In this case, we're letting the user change a color in the list of locations that they're at. And we provide a various set of primitives for you. And we'll actually render the edit window for you. The third section of the gadget, which is perhaps one of the most interesting, is your content. You can basically, your content basically goes into this content section. And you can put anything you want in there. We don't filter that content. You can put CSS, JavaScript, whatever. As you can see, this has a static string and then some CSS and some HTML. There are two other interesting types of gadgets. It says type equals HTML. There's type equals HTML inline and type equals URL. I'm going to focus on type equals HTML today because this is the most interesting. If you have questions about the others, you can talk to me afterwards. So user prefs are the variables by which you allow users to customize your gadget. You can also store state in this gadget. These are like persistent variables. You can think of this as a generic data store for whatever information you want to store. It could be generated or serialized objects or anything like that. This example says last visit, and it saves the time that the user last visited. For every user preference you specify, we'll generate an edit field for you. You don't have to bother with creating this form or persisting the data. We'll generate it programmatically. So this is a complete example of a gadget that both reads and sets user preferences. And I'll go over the red parts first. The require feature set prefs tells the infrastructure that you're actually going to set preferences. By default, you can only read preferences, and there's two ways to read preferences. So I'll talk about reading preferences and then setting preferences. Reading preferences can be done in one of two ways. You can use the igprefs API, which you instantiate, and then it provides you get and set methods, and you can access those variables based on the string name. So in this example, text. Text is a hidden data type, which the user hidden data type means they will not see it in the edit menu, but you can still persist data. Another way to access these values is with static substitutions. If you look at the CSS in the style section, it says background color colon underscore underscore UP underscore color. When this gadget is rendered, we will in real time replace the UP color with the color that the user has specified in their user preferences. So in this case, it would be red. So this is all the code that's needed to implement this note gadget. It's a very simple notepad-like functionality. So we need a way for the user to save their preferences. So we've added an event to the save note button. When they click that, we take the content of that text and store it into the user preference in the red JavaScript code there. So pretty simple, pretty quick to write. And if there was a good internet connection right now, I would do a full demo end-to-end for you. But I'll save that for last just in case it doesn't work. So the Google Gadget API, in addition to providing the preferences, also provides some rather really interesting features. One of them is the ability to fetch remote content, which I'll talk about later. This lets you interact with remote APIs. Tabs and mini messages are ways to really improve the functionality of your user interface. These are both fully programmable APIs. Tabs let you programmably add and delete tabs. You can move them around. And you can also hook JavaScript events into any of these things so that you get callbacks when those users happen. And that's really interesting for tracking usage, which I'll talk about in a minute. Mini messages are kind of like Toast in the Windows pop-up, but for gadgets instead. And you can also control when these appear and how you make them disappear and all that stuff. We have a Flash library, which makes it a two-line method to implement a Flash app in your gadget, and dynamic height, which is really useful for gadgets that change their height. So gadgets that display different kinds of content at different times might have different size requirements, and you want your gadget to take just the right amount of height. Additional libraries we have are analytics, which I'll talk about, set prefs, which I showed you in the previous slide, so you actually store preferences. Grid and drag let you create drag and drop based applications such as games with very little work. And maplets, which are gadgets on maps.google.com, which I think most of you have seen earlier. Importing the code to use those other APIs is really trivial. You just throw in this additional XML syntax, require feature equals X, and we'll automatically inject the JavaScript for you. So I'll cover a bunch of tricks now. So if you've written a gadget, these might be interesting to you because you might not have seen them so far. writing a gadget is fun, but it's really fun when you see the number of users increase, because you probably want your content to be used by somebody. The first pass at looking at this data is the directory will display an approximate page views per week number. This is a really, really simple Wikipedia gadget. It's simply a form field, and it gets 32 million page views per week, which is a testament to the reach that the iGoogle product has. If simple page views is not an interesting enough metric for you, we've written an analytics library which integrates with the Google Analytics feature, so you can add more robust and interesting tracking to your application. Usage is pretty simple. You just throw in your analytics account number and a tracking path. And this demonstrates kind of how much more rich this reporting information is than the scalar 32 million number. Because these are JavaScript events, you can actually hook this into any user action. So I mentioned earlier that the user can change tabs. Well, you can hook in a callback to say, call this analytics method every time the user changes a tab, and it will report that number. And then you can generate reports on this page to display how users are actually using your gadget. Embedding Flash, as I mentioned, we've made really trivial. That's the code that everyone uses to implement Flash, but you'll notice there's a lot of duplicate data in there. It's really long. It's easy to get wrong. It's really easy to break. So we've taken care of that for you by creating this ig embed flash method. This takes care of all the cross-browser problems, and it also makes sure that your flash will look good on the iGoogle product. So using remote content is one of the most interesting features of the API. This lets you interact with any API on the internet that supports GET. So this means RSS feeds. This could mean getting map data, anything, geolocation. And we cache this for performance reasons, and I'll talk about that in a bit. We also make this as easy on you as possible. Everyone talks about how easy it is to just get feeds and stuff, but it's actually really not that easy because a lot of the content on the internet is malformed or is in a strange format that you won't recognize. So what we've done is create a fetch feed as JSON method, which takes an Atom or RSS feed and transforms it into a native JavaScript structure. We use the Google Reader backend, so we actually can handle all of the different kinds of malformed feeds as possible. So it's very low work, and I'll show you an example of how to use that in a second. Fetch XML content is really good for if you want to pull down XML content of any structure, and we'll transform that into a JavaScript structure for you. And fetch content is useful if you're fetching unstructured data that you can't really parse as XML. So this is good for text files, game information, TSVs or CSVs. So to illustrate how simple the fetch feed to JSON method is, this is an example JavaScript snippet that transforms the news.google.com API into a set of news articles displayed in a gadget. You simply make the request to fetch feed as JSON, provide a callback as you would any other XHR request, and you can simply iterate over the responses and display the data as you see fit. So I showed you a directory slide earlier that was internationalized to Japanese. And when you add that content actually gets added in Japanese. The user will see Japanese. This is made possible by a localization feature that we have in the API. In the gadget spec XML file, you can point to XML files hosted anywhere in the web that conform to this message bundle format. And this is simply a name value mapping of label to translation. So we have an English translation, which maps title to title and hello to hello world. And the Japanese example is title to title and hello to whatever that is in Japanese. And the way you display those messages is using the underscore underscore message underscore syntax that's in the lower left there. And we'll replace those at runtime for you. We'll fetch the content and we'll cache everything. Speaking of caching, we will cache everything. You can distribute your content through gadgets for basically no cost. We will do all the hosting for you. We cache your gadget specs. And the content you get with the fetch XML content, your message bundles, we'll cache your images and your SWIFTs and everything. This is really useful if you write a gadget and it happens to get 160 million page views a week. How are you going to host the content? Most people can't serve 156 million page views a week without melting down their hosting provider. So we provide three methods to make this really easy for you to do. Get image, get image URL, and get cached URL. Get image and get image URL are really useful for fetching images, and get cached URL is useful for fetching anything that can be pointed out with a URL. And here are examples how to use them. this is pretty straightforward. I would do a demo, but the internet doesn't work. So yes, you can cache binary files like SWIFTs also. And that really helps if you're a very popular gadget. Google Gadgets and Google Maps have kind of come together in the Maplets product, which is very, very exciting. It might not have been clear, but the gadgets, the Maplets, are actually full complete gadgets. They conform to the same syntax. They have the same APIs available to them. You could use tabs in that gadget on the left-hand side if you'd like. And then in addition, you get access to all of the Maps API, which will draw on this map. So if you haven't seen that yet, I highly recommend that you do. OK, I'm going to try and do the demos for you, but I don't make any promises about it actually working. So what I'd like to do is walk you through the creation of a gadget that actually makes a fetch content request. And displays it to you. There we go. So we're going to recreate this gadget. This gadget's fetching a feed from the Google blog search with a query of Google Developer Day and displaying the most recent three postings. So a good place to start when you're learning about the API is to search for Google Gadgets API. The first result has a lot of really great starting links for this. I recommend you start here in the developer guide, and then go down here and look at Scratchpad. Scratchpad is like a mini IDE that you can use to prototype gadgets. So I'll do a little demo here. This is Hello World, and we can preview the gadget, and it displays Hello World. And to prove that this is actually happening in real time, we'll say Hello London, and it says Hello London. We can make this a little more interesting by throwing in some user pref. And giving a value, England. We can do. So this is using the static variable substitution I mentioned earlier. This name corresponds to this name. Hello, England. All right, so that's fun, but let's make this a little more interesting and take this gadget that I happen to have here. We can look at it here. Give it a second. There you go. Right. All right, any questions? I think they'll be bringing out some mics for you to come up. Yes.
Hi. Yeah. It's probably a basic question, but I haven't built a gadget before. But is the what's actually parsing and generating the JavaScript for the gadget? Are you actually parsing the XML file locally on the client side and then generating what's seen? Or is there a back-end process that when the gadget's uploaded that's preparing everything ready?
Okay, so the question is the gadget spec being parsed on the client side on the browser or is it being cached on the server? It's actually cached on Google. Google parses this file, fetches all the necessary content, and assembles it into one piece of content that gets sent to the user.
If the gadget is running in Google Desktop, what component renders the HTML and what JavaScript engine gets to run?
Sorry, I didn't...
If the gadget's running on Google Desktop, what renders the HTML and which JavaScript engine handles any JavaScript that's in the gadget? Because it wouldn't be presumably necessarily the user's web browser.
Okay, so the question is what rendering engine of the gadget rendered in Google Desktop? I believe it's Internet Explorer.
Well, not on Google Desktop for the Mac, presumably?
Oh, Google Desktop for the Mac. I don't know. Right. I would assume Safari, though.
Thanks.
Yeah, I just wondered, could you actually go a couple of slides back and show us the code for that RSS reader?
For which one?
The RSS reader that you copy and pasted in? It was very quick.
Yes.
That one, yeah.
Yes. Let me format this, it's a little easier to read.
Just wondered, with things like the prototype and Scriptacus libraries, would they be potentially available in there if you called them in?
Yeah, absolutely. The content of all of the text in the content section, that C data, basically gets injected into an HTML document. So we provide an HTML header and a body tag and a closed body tag. Your content just gets shoved in the middle there. So you can throw in additional script tags here.
Yeah, I see you've got things like an underline gel, which presumably, I'm not sure where that one actually comes from.
So we also throw a bunch of other methods at you. I probably should have had a slide on this. Gel is a simple wrapper around get element by ID. There's a bunch of others, get element by tag name, which have other abbreviations.
I think everybody else calls them just dollar, yeah. All right, thanks.
There's other methods in there that also provide escaping. There's an event handling framework, so you can hook into events on the container page, so there's a lot of them.
And a question about the internationalization. What does the gadget server do when a language is requested that you haven't explicitly supported in your internationalization spec?
It will fall back in order that they are in the definition of the file. So you don't get an error, but you'll get one not in your language.
But you have no control over what your default is going to be?
The default, I believe, is the first one.
I see.
I guess this is more of a question regarding the iGoogle or Google Start Page kind of framework, which obviously the gadgets are an important part of. Just thinking about limitations, and perhaps most of the focus so far has been on end user, Wikipedia search or a pony, are very much focused on me. But if we're to extend this platform into an enterprise solution, or at least pockets of, do you see particular limitations or areas where it could actually go beyond where it is now? So it's a bit of an open-ended question.
Sure. Yeah, all of the examples I've given so far have been very targeted to an individual user, so that there haven't been much as far as collaboration there. There actually are a lot of gadgets that do offer collaboration features, so I'm typing a magic URL here. The internet works. This should add a gadget that is a standard Google gadget using the public APIs that implements a Docs and Spreadsheets feature, so you can integrate with other collaboration stuff. And you also mentioned enterprise in particular. There is another type of gadget that I mentioned, type URL, which is really useful when rendering gadgets in enterprise, so you can just point to an internal application. Type URL gadgets in general are really useful if you just want to take an existing app and throw it in a gadget. You're not going to try and customize it for that gadget or anything. You can just make a type URL, and all that does is create an iframe that points to the URL you specify, so that you don't need to put your content in the gadget spec itself. Does that answer your question? Okay, I guess if there's no more questions, I'll be around here afterwards, so feel free to talk to me. Thank you for coming.